Welcome to City Week, ladies and gentlemen. Today I have the pleasure of sitting down with one of our local homegrown heroes here. And I do say hero because this young lady has served 27 years in the military. So I just want to say, first of all, thank you for your service to our country.
You're welcome.
And I want to introduce to everybody Miss Sandra Brownlee. Sandra, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, you know what? We were joking before we came on, and I had to get you on after you ran over me in the parking lot. So this is my healing process.
So now that's the news.
That's the news. That's
okay. That I ran over
that
you.
That you ran over me in the parking lot. I'm just kidding, no, Sandra. But it is a pleasure to sit down with you and talk about something that I know that is very near and dear to your heart.
Yes.
And it should be to all of us, because everybody is not necessarily cut out to do the work that you have done and that our next guests have done, and that is defending our country. Sandra, tell us a little bit about yourself, and then we're going to jump right into your program.
So, of course, as Zelton said, I'm a homegrown. I was born and raised here in LaGrange, Georgia. I was actually born in a house over on the south side of town. Uh-huh. I did what every other kid do growing up. I lived my life in my neighborhood. I went to the local rec center. I think Mr. Weatherington was there, Mr. Griggs, and
right.
Mr. English were the guys who sort of were like our daytime babysitters.
And that's right.
You grew up in your neighborhood, loving your neighborhood and community. And I don't know why, and I cannot tell you where the unction came to join the service, because there's no one in my family who, there's no history of service members in my family.
Uh-huh.
I can tell you that I watched a show one time called MASH. You ever seen that show, MASH?
Oh, yeah. We all have watched MASH.
Yeah, right. And then there was a nurse on there called Houlihan, who was like a really tough chick, you know?
That's right.
So I thought, you know, one thing I always felt in my heart I wanted to do was travel. But number two, I thought, I'm going to join the military.
Okay.
And actually, prior to me even being of age, I went down to the recruiting station when I was like 16 and said, I want to join the military. And they were like, why? And I was like, I don't know, but I just want to join. Of course, my family said, no, go to school, shut it down. Yes.
Uh-huh.
So I did what we call delayed entry, and I stayed on the military on delayed entry for a year.
Mm-hmm.
And then I graduated from high school in July of that year, I left for basic training. And awesome. So, yes, 27 awesome. Years of military medical service. I served as a combat medic. I was went to two combat conflicts, several deployments,
okay.
And just my job was taking care of our veterans.
Mm.
And so I did that for a very long time, and I caught great joy in doing it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Met some great people along the way, have good buddies, and I retired from the military. So when people retire, you think, okay, all is well. You get a retirement check, you can sit back, you can fish on the dock of the bay or whatever you want to do.
That's right.
It's not that simple. Nice. Because what I realized was, and it hit me one day when I was coming home from downtown Atlanta, mm-hmm. and on the corner there was a guy with a sign that said, I'm a homeless vet.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept saying, okay, that doesn't make sense to me. How does homelessness and veteran fit in the same sentence? It didn't make sense.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't make sense every time I saw it from that point on. And I just thought about that thing, and I thought, this is not what we do. And when you talk about someone like myself who took care of veterans or soldiers for 27 years, you can't just stop doing what you've been doing your whole life, what mm-hmm. you were designed to do.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so one day, one of my old soldiers from one of my own soldiers called me, and he said to me that he's in a state of mind that he doesn't know what to do with himself and he don't know where to go. And I asked him where he was. He was under a bridge in Decatur.
Oh my.
He was. But let me preface this by saying, when we serve in the military, we give our all to the military. That is our function. From the time that you raise your hand at that MEP station, you have now decided a whole new path for your life, and that is to defend this country against all enemies.
Mm-hmm.
And the person next to you and the person next to them are saying the same thing. So you become a cohesive team to do one thing, and that's your focal point. It was mine for 27 years, was to defend this country.
Mm-hmm.
So I wasn't worried about things like we didn't have time to, you know, learn about paying bills or getting jobs or mm-hmm. interacting with the community, because mm-hmm. that was our community. That was our life to do. So when you leave the service, be it 27 years like I did, or be it four like some soldiers may do, when you leave that installation for the last time, if you didn't retire,
mm-hmm.
then that installation is done. Nothing against the military, because our job is one thing, defend this country.
Right.
The VA is supposed to, and the community is supposed to take care of us once we leave the service.
Mm-hmm.
That is the plan. It doesn't often work that way, and we can see it based on the 22 soldiers who are committing suicide every day, based on the soldiers that are homeless, based on things of that nature, soldiers who are committing crimes and acts that are unbeknownst to us in the military. So all of that brought me to a conclusion of that something that has to be done. And I really did pray about that thing really long and hard and asked for a way that I could actually improve our lives as veterans in the community, thus by improving the community as a whole. And so I started a nonprofit called Discovering Soldiers' Potential.
I was going to ask you, out of all of that, birthed an organization.
Yes.
And if you don't mind, give us that name again.
Discovering Soldiers' Potential 2 is the name of my nonprofit.
Okay. And also, Sandra, I wanted to ask a question because I heard you talk about you went into the delayed entry program.
Yes.
Talk about the age of individuals that are going into the service. And you know, some of them may do 4 years, some of them may do 20 or 30 years like you did. Talk about that if you don't mind.
So first of all, the average age for kids who are joining are between the ages of 18 and 24.
So that gives itself to that not being that fully trained, correct?
And not only that, most of us join when we're at that informative age where most of us are going off to college or we're getting jobs and we're living in the community and we learn how to manage things and do things that the community does. We're in the military, they don't teach you that. We're being trained to decompress all of that and learn something new, how to train, how to fight, how to protect this country. Two totally different worlds we're living in.
Absolutely.
So by the time they leave, some leave, like I said, 27 years, but the average soldier's leaving the military after 1 to 2 tours, especially now with the climate with Bosnia and then, of course, Iraq and those things of deployments are just back to back. So kids are leaving a lot sooner than normal. The problem is that when they leave, they go back home. You're glad to see them that first couple of days that they're back home. There's parades, there's all these things. But after that, what do you do now? They don't understand how the community runs and the community doesn't understand how they run. And that's where the conflict lies. That chasm between leaving the service and integrating into the community is where most of the problems lie. And that's why I decided to start Discovering Soldiers' Potential too.
And you talked about, you know, trying to make that transition back over from military, you know, mindset to that civilian mindset. And for you, you find in researching and talking about how to be able to bridge that gap. Talk about that for us, if you don't mind.
So the first thing that I came to realize, even myself, because it was difficult for me to reincorporate. I mean, after doing one thing a certain way for your entire life, to now have to readjust your whole way of thinking became really be mentally taxing, not only physically, but mentally taxing. And then we have these cases of PTSD that are on the rise every day. But I will tell you this, while we're in the military, you don't hear that number of PTSD. We don't even understand those letters while we're on active duty. That happens post-service when you realize.
That's just how focused you are, right?
Exactly. So coming back home and not knowing how to take those energies you've learned in the military and then reincorporate them back into the communities where we hopefully DSP2 and our Waypoint Veteran Service Centers come together to make that thing happen for veterans, regardless to the era that they served. We've served as veterans from World War II in Korea to present day. I'm so excited about that. I'm excited about the fact that we have veterans of all walks of life and ages that will come to our service centers to seek assistance on all of those what-if questions that they have when they leave the military that no one ever answered.
And you know, you talked about homelessness, the gentleman that reached out to you that was living under the bridge in Decatur. What is the second, I guess, leading thing that you see veterans are in need of?
Housing. I will say that all day.
Okay.
Because when you leave the service and you come home, you get to stay with mom. But just like, you know, anything else after a few days or weeks, mom's like, okay, what are you going to do now? You can't just sit on the sofa all day.
Get up off the sofa, right?
And so he doesn't know because the average soldier is used to being told what they're going to, they know what their game plan is every day. You know, based on your job, what you're going to do every day. Well, you don't know what you're going to do every day out here because no one's set you on a path to get that. So when Waypoint Veteran Service Centers were open, I opened my very first one in 2016 in Spalding County, Griffin. So excited about that service center because it allowed me to have a place where veterans could come and bring those questions. But not only come and bring those questions, but come and be in a place where like-minded folks understood where they were coming from, regardless to what branch you were in. So when you arouse someone who thinks like you, you will be more apt to share all the things that you need. And because of that, we become a full-fledged service center, not just here in LaGrange, but also in Spalding County. We have a service center in Macon. And so we're doing just amazing things. I'm trying to hit every veteran that needs my assistance. It's a nonprofit, Alta, so we don't charge for our services. Our veterans don't pay for anything when they come see me.
Awesome. Yes. You know, Sandra, we could talk on and on and on.
Yes.
Because it's something that I feel like the entire community can get behind. Because when individuals like yourselves and all those that have raised their hand and sworn to defend this country, that's a unique individual.
Yes.
And we didn't mention your branch of service.
Yes.
So if you don't mind, as we close out, mention the branch that you served in, Sandra.
Well, as I said before, I served in the Army.
Okay.
And I emphasize the Army because whenever we're interacting with our peers like Air Force or Marines or, you know, Navy, they're saying, you know, what branch are you from? And I'm saying, well, there's only one branch. That's the Army. We created all the others.
That's
so
right. Okay.
We get lots of cohesiveness and camaraderie from things like that.
Well, we are, again, we do appreciate your service tremendously, Sandra. And I'm going to follow up your interview with your executive director,
yes.
Terrence Lawrence, is going to come on. And he's going to dive deep down into some more of the information that you all are providing to our veterans. So,
yes.
Again, Sandra, I just want to say thank you very much for being my guest.
You're quite welcome.
Today. All right.
It's been a pleasure to sit with you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned for more City Week coming up in just a moment.